where I left off. I'm white.
That is pretty clean.
Oh, wait a minute, it shouldn't be clean. Wait, something here is wrong.
That'd be pretty clean.
You wanted to report, I mean. How do you make it? Okay. Right now, I would just like to review a little bit of research. Sorry, I got myself out of place for the notes. Okay, I want to put up a slide to the graph that Born and King did. I don't think we need to turn the lights off because this is a graph. You should be able to see it all right. You see the slide effect that seems to be going on.
Gary?
Gary, go.
Okay. Okay, you should be able to see that without the, without turning the lights down. Warner King was a really well-known occupational therapist for Phoenix fam. And if you work with a child, maybe we just get a few off in the front, but not enough to really, pick up the camera. And if you work with a child on speech while he was swinging on the swing, you got much more verbalization out of it. Okay, this is before he went on the swing here, and this is after he went on the swing. And during, swinging on the swing, much more speech came out. You know, he was getting vestibular stimulation, and this has a really good, oftentimes it's a very good effect on the brain. Now, you always want to keep these things fun games. It's just amazing, what it can do. Put this slide up here just to remind me to talk about rhythm. Really not all that important to slide, just some airplanes flying in formation. And one problem I had is I couldn't coordinate my rhythm with somebody else's rhythm. Condon in Boston has found that autistic babies don't synchronize their movements with normal adult speech. Well, even now I sometimes will interrupt because I just can't see where to break in. I don't follow along with somebody else's rhythm. I can keep a rhythm on my own, but the problem that I have is I can't synchronize that rhythm with somebody else. And a couple of years ago, I went and had a brain scan and found out that I have an abnormality in the cerebellum. But there's an easier way to test for an abnormality in the cerebellum than, $1,000 brain scan. I was watching the news one night and they were demonstrating the drunk test and walking the dotted line to see whether you're drunk. I thought, well, I'll try that. Well, I tried it and I flunked. I cannot balance. I put one foot in front of the other. I absolutely cannot balance. Can't balance at all. It's an abnormality of the cerebellum. And Eric Corshane in San Diego has found that high-functioning autistics, 14 out of 18, had an abnormality that showed up in the brain scan. And it showed up in my brain scan. But as a little kid, I was good in sports, but there were certain things I couldn't do. One of the things I could never learn how to do properly was a Christie in skiing, where you keep both skis together and do those beautiful turns, just keeping them together, like Christie to one side, Christie to the right, but I couldn't do my Christie to the left. Now, throwing a ball, catching a ball was just hard. And last night I was visiting with my Kirsten Krause, who's an OT and now studying to be a doctor, almost got her MD. She gave me a standard test last night the neurologist does, the cerebellar function, touch your nose, touch the finger out here, touch this, I can do that all right. I can do everything all right and pass it, except for this tandem walking. And I'm finding as I'm going to meetings, I'm sort of informally testing on people with tandem walking and seeing if they can do it. And I'm very interested in some of the autistics that are here tonight when the conference is over with, We could do a little tandem walk. There may be some patterns of who has this problem and who doesn't. And that's just not known yet. They're pretty sure it's a subtype, and we don't know what subtype. Interesting enough, talking about stimulating the cerebellum, you know, I was telling you about these animals that become autistic if they're sensory deprived. You know, you probably heard of Harlow's monkeys. Some of the monkeys were raised where they had a, you know, cloth surrogate mother they could go on, and that helped them a lot, you know, rather than just bearing keys or nothing. But they still had a lot of autistic behavior. But if they gave them something to cling to that rocked, then they didn't develop all this terrible autistic type behavior. They stimulated the vestibular system in the cerebellum, they had a very good effect. Now exactly why this works or how it works, not all that well known. But it's definitely known that it does. I think sometimes we have a tendency to try to over-explain. You know, as I travel around to different schools, I find that each one sort of gets its own dogma, like its own religion. And they get so married to the theory, they're not willing to update it as new information comes in. See, this is an apparatus that you might want to turn the lights on just briefly so we can see that. I was in Boston visiting Miller's school in Boston, and he made a lot of apparatus where the kids have to do a lot of balancing, and a lot of watching where they're going so they don't step in the holes. And while they're doing these kind of activities, they're stimulating the cerebellum, and sometimes speech comes out, and better behavior comes out. This is just another way of doing it. You know, a lot of different ways of achieving the same thing. He came up with these ideas because he found an autistic kid playing on a construction site. Maybe that's not a very good place to be playing, walking on boards, you know, trying to balance. And a lot of the stereotypic behavior was missing while he was doing this, and speech got somewhat better. The idea is, you know, here are funny steps where they've got to really pay attention to what they're doing. You know, when you have, you know, these sorts of tasks, it seems to, you know, stimulate, you know, they're always having to balance, watch where they're going, pay attention to what they're doing. And while you're doing this, it has a good effect clinically. Now, where we really get in trouble is we get into some sort of BS sort of explanations as to why some of this stuff works. The theory as to why some of the stuff may work, I just want to throw up. I want to just say that we know from clinical practice certain things work. When you put kids on swings, good things happen. When you do all these various sensory desensitization exercises, you know, to break down tactile defensiveness, you can get a child who doesn't want to be touched to tolerate being touched. And it has a good effect clinically. I was talking with a lady tonight, you know, it's on delicato stuff, and I'm glad to hear that he's getting off the patterning business for autism, you know, and doing an all sensory program, and a lot of it makes a good bunch of sense. Because patterning for autism, I have a hard time with that. It may be effective in some cases, but I think the explanation of why it works is totally wrong. And I think we're better off to say, okay, there's certain things that seem to work. Let's do those things that work. We know that stimulating the cerebellum is good. We know the cerebellum is damaged in autism. In certain forms of autism, there's abnormalities in brainstem transmission time. There's various abnormalities in that part of the brain. When you stimulate it, good things happen. Now, exactly how or why it works, we better not speculate too much, except where we've got data to back it up. You know, I often use an example. I said, let's say you took an electronic calculator. You put that calculator in a time machine and you sent it back 100 years. And you asked the top scientists of the world 100 years ago to figure out how an electronic calculator works. Well, they had good microscopes then. They could put it under a microscope and they could do a really good anatomy of the chip. You know, they could see all the little circuitry on the chip, figure out all the anatomy, do a volt potentials from the keys up to different parts of the chip, and know how it works. Know what? We got to remember, we still do not know how the brain stores information. That we don't know. We must not forget. But when we find that certain things work, you know, let's use those things. And now getting into brain scans, I think we're going to want to see this slide. This is a normal brain scan. Eric Borshain in California has been doing a lot of work with brain scans. The vermis, the cerebellum, the center line of the cerebellum, the normal person here. This little piece right here, in some autistics, is smaller than normal. And in some, the whole cerebellum itself may be smaller than normal. And if you have somebody that cannot tandem walk, cannot do, you know, what I just showed you, can't put one foot in front of the other without falling over, they have got cerebellar abnormality. Now that's diagnostic for us. And Eric Corshane found 14 out of 18 autistics, high-functioning autistics, adult autistics, had this small vermis. Now, there was another study done by Ritvo, and he found he was comparing children, looking at children, and his sample was much lower functioning, and he didn't find any difference between the controls and the experimentals. Okay, now why? I think there's two possible explanations. Age, maybe this shows up more in the scan in older people. But I've been finding a number of, you know, pre-pubertal kids who can't tandem walk. But I don't know what their scan results are, but I know they can't tandem walk. And another possible explanation is the level of functioning. Eric Corshane had a very high functioning sample. It would lay still in a brain scan machine for an hour without moving. If you move, it wrecks the scan and blurs it. And the Ritvo sample was a much lower functioning sample. Maybe it's a different subtypes. So this cerebellar abnormality probably only shows up in certain subtypes. And I have a feeling it may be showing up in some of the higher functioning subtypes. Fragile X autistics also have abnormality in the cerebellum. Why would the cerebellum have such a big effect? Well, there's a few things that we know in animal studies. Show how the cerebellum modulates sensory input. You take a cat, I found these old papers, really old, 1939, everyone's forgotten about them, they're in the library, just, you know, getting dusty, but I found them. And there was one researcher found that if you take a cat and you put an electrode down in the center line of the vermis, and we can get the light, you want the lights back on, you can. I don't have any slides you really need to see for a while yet. Put an electrode in the center line of the vermis of the cat, right in here, sitting right in here. Now, being an old paper that hit back in 1939, they were not very clear exactly where they stuck. But what the interesting thing happened was the cat got hypersensitive to sound and touch. All of a sudden, you got an animal that touched and it jumped, you know, tactically defensive, and it jumped at loud noise. It became super sensitive to sound and touch. You know, it somehow modulated. There was another experiment that Prescott did with a monkey that was isolated and had become autistic. You know, autistic behavior from sensory deprivation. It went in and cut out the big part of the midline of the cerebellum. The monkey got tamed. There's also been work done in humans where they stimulated the cerebellum in humans that had electrodes implanted in epilepsy. And you got changes in mood. And then another experiment, they stimulated another part of the cerebellum, and the level of stimulation affected what the cat did. It stimulated a little bit, it grew. You know, that's a fairly pleasant activity. Stimulated a little more, it would go eat some food, stimulated it more, and the cat went into flying rage and went nuts. You know, there's excitatory and inhibitory circuits in the cerebellum. One part stimulated, it like turns the volume control up, another part inhibits. I mean, that's as far as we know about how the cerebellar vermis thing works. There's also evidence that rats where you damage part of this will startle more readily. This we know, but that's the extent of knowledge. To speculate much more as to how this all fits in with the rest of the brain, it's really not all that well known. We're going to get into tracing circuits and calculators. Now, I got another slide. It's just my library slide, so I want to talk about research. The beautiful old library, the monastery in Vienna that I visited on convention. And I discussed earlier these tune-ins some of these people get. They get a little tune-out in hearing. And there's been some work where some of these tantrums and sudden outbursts were like a seizure. And a seizure drug like Tegretol sometimes works. Okay, let's just look at some family history data that Joe Piven and John Hopkins did. He compared true Kanner type autistics. These are ones diagnosed by Tanner himself, a true genetic autism, not caused by pregnancy damage or rubella or, you know, encephalitis or fragile X, versus a sample from the Autism Society that's got the whole mixed bag of all the different kinds of autism. And he looked at the family histories for cognitive dysfunctions, things like dyslexia, and also what they call social dysfunction, which would be if you have a sibling who's a little bit weird, a little bit nerdy, you know, an engineer with a plastic pen holder that's a little bit weird. And he found that in the Canners group, you had a much higher incidence of siblings with things such as dyslexia. Now, I'm also finding, as we spoke about earlier, that I'm finding other things, you know, like depression, manic depression, panic and anxiety type problems. Maybe not bad enough to go to the doctor for. Patterns are there. The good things that are being, I'm finding, are things like, you know, great talent in drawing. Absolutely great talent in drawing. Genius. Gifted child in the same family. And a similar sort of thing has been found in manic depression. You find a manic depression family with manic depression in it. Okay, you have one person who's got manic depression really bad, and they're kind of, you know, had a lot of problems. But then you have a brother and sister, super brilliant artists, a super creative artist. I have an engineering friend who's, it wouldn't diagnose him as manic depressive, but he sure has the traits. You know, he has mood fluctuations, absolutely brilliant, you know, visual thinker. He's designed, probably in the packing industry, he's designed about half of all the equipment used on the beef slaughter floor. And he just draws a drawing, like a plot. I mean, I thought I could draw well. Well, when Wilson draws, he like has it in his head, and he draws just really quick, like a computer plotter is drawing the drawing, like he's tracing it just out of his mind. Just absolutely amazing. Well, Luke Sy, who's now moved up to Michigan, wanted to do a study to say how much hard neurological symptoms do autistics have. Okay, if you just go to the doctor's office and you get the plain ordinary EEG, just a plain ordinary one, not the fancy computerized ones. 50% of all autistics have abnormalities that show up on the plain EEG. Now, if you get a negative EEG, that doesn't mean that there are no problems. The cerebellar abnormality that I'm discussing, that doesn't show up on a regular EEG. 25% had gross pathology on the CAT scan, you know, where there was a lot more, you know, pathology showing up on the brain than just the vermis being small. The ventricles, which is spaces in the brain, were bigger than normal. 33 to 56% had an abnormal brainstem transmission time, which is a measure for how the signal goes through the brainstem when a light is flashed in the eye or they hear a tone. Gilbert in Sweden then went on and got similar results. He also found in high-functioning autism that 20% of fragile X, 50% had an abnormal EEG. Other signs of over-arousal in the nervous system, in other words, the nervous system is too hypered up, is a suppressed P3 wave, which is a special computerized brainwave test, and it comes up positive for over-arousal in the nervous system. And Cantor in 1986 found with a computerized EEG, it's not a regular EEG, that autistic children tend to have an immature brainwave pattern. Like a 7-year-old autistic would have an EEG pattern of a 2-year-old. And another real interesting test that I was in was this eye test that Ritvo's been doing. And in this eye test, they do an evoked potential off the retina. They put a contact lens thing in your eye, shine them flashlights in your eye, and look at these, how the signal is transmitted through the retina. Now, people with a disease called retinitis pigmentosa that are going blind have an abnormal score on this test. So do half of all autistic people. Why? They happen to have perfect 20/20 vision, and I have test results consistent with somebody that should be starting to go blind. Well, I think to speculate as to why this happens, there's something different about the wiring, you know, deep in the brain. And I was talking with Dr. Villamudo today, and he was saying that part of this visual circuit that stimulated that test was through the cerebellum. I know, very interesting. Most interested to learn about that. Now I want to get in and talk about puberty. Slide you all in. Or we'll see the big ski jump. Remind me to talk about how I felt when I got into puberty. Unfortunately, about half of all autistics deteriorate to puberty. That's the bad news. Good news is that someone wouldn't do that. When I got into puberty, I started having these nerves that felt like a constant state of stage fright. I just say, well, just imagine you were doing teacher licensing exams and you felt that nervous every day for no reason. When I talked to the doctors at the medical school today, I said, just imagine when you took your boards. You took your exam to get your medical license. How nervous you'd be. Just imagine if you felt that way every single day. And I would have horrible, these horrible nerve attacks. And then I'd get colitis attacks. Well, I didn't feel like licensing exams or PhD final exams. Then I'd get these colitis attacks, you know, a stress-related disorder. And if colitis was really bad, then I didn't feel nervous, or I'd get headaches. And then if I managed to get rid of the physical symptoms, then I just had terrible nervousness. I was just, you know, already at the bottom of my mind, was nervousness. And I found if I went on the roller carnival ride, it would temporarily relieve and pressure and vestibular stimulation. They even sent away for their catalogs so that I could have a look at it. There, you can't really see it, but I got inside the roller with the camera and took a picture, it spins around, the floor drops out. And there you are, stuck up on the wall. Now, there are a lot of things that you can do sensory-wise to reduce arousal. I know of a case in California who was like bouncing off the wall with another drum, and when he got an exercise program and he got sensory treatment, it really made a big difference in, you know, his behavior, and a lot of the temper and a lot of the aggressive behavior stopped. Well, about 8 years ago, I was reading the Psychology Today magazine, and I was reading a, I think we can see that with the lights on, don't know the name of those drugs. I read the drug Topranil. That's the brand name, and Mipramine, and I think I got an extra M in that. It was still wrong on one of my prescription bottles. But then I looked it up in the PDR, and by the time I looked it up, I'd already made the slide. And I read this antidepressant drug. This is a drug used for treating depression. And through accidental discovery, it was learned that this drug works for anxiety and panic attacks. You know, if you have, you know, there's an aunt in the family that doesn't want to go across bridges, doesn't want to leave the house, constantly anxious, you give her a Mipramine, you know, Topranil. And it works for that. Well, I started taking this drug, 50 milligrams a day, at night, before I go to bed. It was like magic. Now, this disinformation, that's just sort of the new improved Topranil. Maybe it works a little better for fewer side effects. It's main advantage. And actually, if you're in crisis, you want to use disinformation, it's the new improved version. But it was just amazing, the difference. I was no longer nervous. I can tell you it was a revelation to have a pill come along and make those nerves go away. For 20 years, I tried to find my deep, dark secrets to make nerves go away. Now, if I did all my sensory things and I used the squeeze machine as an adolescent, maybe I could get my nervous system to come from 200 miles an hour to 150 miles an hour. But the most relaxed I could get myself might be 125. Now, I think there's two beneficial things the squeeze machine can do. Okay, it helped calm down my nerves, but the other thing it helps do is break down tactile defensiveness and get that feeling of being held and the feeling of comfort, which I think is essential. You know, for a child, you know, to develop properly. I'm not saying that should replace contact with people, but it's a way that you can, like, get the door open. Yeah, because as you said earlier, I think you got to have that feeling, otherwise you're not going to, you know, you're going to be problems. But it was a revelation that a drug come along and make his nerves go away. Looking for my deep, dark secrets, that didn't do any good at all. A little magic pink pill on the top and all the pink pill or the green pill and morphine, little magic pill came along and made it go away. Now I want to tell some things that have been learned about these drugs and using them. First of all, I'm basically anti-drug prior to puberty. A lot of autistic deteriorate at puberty and I think the place for proper use of drugs. I'm taking a pill that I don't care if I find out it's going to take 10 years off my life. My life has been improved so much by getting that horrible nervous system arousal level down. Yeah, if you try this, you have to use a much lower dose than what's used to treat depression. You just, if your doctor just opens up the PDR, that's the physician's desk reference, gets the dose different pressure and gives it to an autistic teenager or an autistic adult, they may just go right through the ceiling. Now, you can look at it sort of this way. You can look at it as two circuits in the brain. Now, this is not a very scientific way to put it, but it's a good way to look at it when you're trying to figure out what the dose should be. You got one circuit in the brain, sort of a manic depression circuit. That's the circuit that the drug was invented for. And then you've got another circuit, an anxiety circuit. And it just turns out that a side effect of the drug works on the anxiety circuit. Now, the thing is, you got to give enough to get rid of the anxiety, but don't give so much that you push it up into the manic side on the manic depression circuit to throw the person through the ceiling. Because there's been some cases where they gave it too much and it's disastrous. You've got to find the lowest dose that works. And sometimes that dose is as low as 10 milligrams every other day. This is something that Dr. Hardy in Boston and Dr. Rady in Boston have learned. You've got to use very, very low doses. And once you find a dose, you stick with that dose and you don't change it. And this brings up another thing, relapses. I was on it for 2 or 3 months and then I got a nerve relapse. Now I knew that my nerves would tend to go in cycles. And I figured, well, I just gotta live through this relapse. And thank goodness I didn't run and take more of it. It might not have worked if I'd done that. Now the dose that will work is gonna vary from person to person. Another thing is, we don't know how to diagnose subtypes yet. The drug that worked for me may be horrible, totally, absolutely horrible for somebody else. You know, and unfortunately, I have to be done by trial and error. Dr. Hardy in Boston has treated about 25 or 30 high-functioning older autistics. I'm not recommending you run out and give this stuff to children. And has had some very good results. So while I'm talking about drugs for children, one thing you got to make sure is that they're not messing up the vision. And that, you know, the kids can see properly if they're on drugs. A lot of these drugs have a side effect of blurring vision, including coughing. But you're using very, very, very long doses. Dr. Hardy's also worked with trazodone and Prozac. Those are two other brand new ones that have just been invented. They're like new antidepressants, and sometimes they might work even better. But these nerves go in cycles. They got to live through the relapse. I'll put this slide up here just to remind me to talk about being slow to change. Even though I felt relief right away, my behavior didn't just change overnight. It took time. And it's been very interesting talking to people that see me intermittently, like they see me every couple of years. And they say, your behavior's really improved. And I have a friend that hadn't seen me. I just saw her at Christmas and she hadn't seen me except for one brief time at a meeting. She had not seen me for an extended period of time, for 7 years, the whole time I've been taking this drug. She says, I can't believe how you've changed. I said, okay, how have I changed? She says, we don't fidget anywhere near as much. We've got better eye contact. Your voice is more modulated. You don't hunch over anymore. You don't swallow all the time. And she said, you used to act like you were always out of breath all the time. You know, people noticing a change, but change takes place gradually. Because you don't unlearn 20 years of behavior instantly. You see, behavior and biology interact. And you don't just change behavior overnight just because nerves got calmed down. You know, it's a gradual thing. Well, Rady in Boston with adult autistics that are in the state mental hospital, some of them on the back ward, drowning in all kinds of other drugs, he got them off the back ward with beta blockers. That's blood pressure medicine. Beta blockers, class drugs, propranolol is a chemical name, and I think the brand name is Underol. And, you know, again, this isn't going to work in everybody. There's some people it works. There was a guy there with an IQ of 120, and he got him off the back ward, you know, with this drug. One of the things he said is it doesn't happen overnight. It takes time for behavior to change. It doesn't, you know, just happen instantly. Now, obviously, of course, to try this, you got to make darn sure you don't get the blood pressure down too low and get some kind of problem, you know, have it collapse because the blood pressure is pushed down below normal. It is blood pressure medicine. But there's some people this will work. And I think these, in the older adults, these are some of the things that need to be tried before we get out some of the old favorites, you know, like how long. So Somebody asked me this morning about B6 and magnesium. We already discussed that. We talked about Haldol. And another, we also did some discussing on allergies. Let's put that up there for filler slide and cats. Also remind me to talk about allergies until I get a better slide to remind me to talk about that. I want to talk just a little bit about a couple of things in allergies. A lot of these kids have got food allergies, allergic to milk, allergic to wheat. I've had parent after parent tell me that. Now you go in and you do an allergy test, you can get a ton of false negatives. Now if the test comes up positive, you can say, yes, he's definitely allergic to milk. But you can't say no. I went in and I took the test and I had mild reactions to milk and corn. And when they first read them, I didn't have any bumps. I do the scratch test. Then after it set for a while, I said, let's leave them on longer. Let's leave it on longer and see what happens. Left it on longer and I started to pop up a few bumps. You know, I mean, a lot of people poo-poo the allergy stuff, but I'm getting too much feedback from meetings like this on allergies. Too many parents are telling me, well, I took them off of milk and I took them off of wheat, and it was a good effect. Now, I don't think I can go along, believe anyone tells me they're going to cure doing that, but there's been substantial improvements in behavior. Okay, getting in subtypes, talked about, you know, the genetic types, the true Tanner type syndrome. Maybe there's two different genetic kinds. Rick Bowe has also been working on tracing the genetics of autism, and in the genetic types, unfortunately, it can spread to the offspring with Prader-Willi X, which is a very specific genetic condition, which also is responsible for a lot of mental retardation. You can get into things like Rett syndrome, which just has an autistic stage. Once in a while, you'll find a case of Candida autism, where a yeast infection gets into the child. It's not common. In all my mind, there's a lot of controversy. Some doctors say it doesn't exist. In mine, and other people say it's like, you know, 10%. I don't think 10% of them have it. It might be a quarter of 1%. But I have run into two sets of parents and talking to them, and I really think they actually did have it. You know, it wasn't their imagination, but I think it really is quite rare. Running tons of ear infections in these kids. You've got to make sure they hear and that their ears aren't clogged up and infected. You know, the studies have shown that seems to go along with autism. I've run into a family where the dad had chemotherapy for cancer and then he had an autistic child with damaged sperm cells. So there's been some work, I think Mary Coleman's done a little work on this, where parents that have been exposed to bad chemicals in their work, solvents and whatnot, there's much damage to genetic material, there's more tendency to have something wrong with the child. She's also worked with the metabolic forms of autism, and when this first came out, we thought, oh boy, put people on a special diet, we're going to cure everybody. It hasn't worked out that way. I've run into a couple of people where they were helped by these diets, especially when they were seizures just all over the brain and they weren't localized in any one place. I know of one case where the kid was wall-to-wall seizures and they couldn't localize it on an EEG. You put them on a special purine diet and the seizures stopped. But again, I think you're dealing with something that is quite rare and is not the, you know, the more common kinds of autism or the genetic kinds and things like rubella or which is German measles during pregnancy or some sort of insult that happens during pregnancy. And we discussed family history. I already discussed it, so we'll discuss that again. Now I want to talk about fixation. Now you gotta take that fixation and you gotta direct it into something constructive. Too many times, you know, school psychologists want to stomp out their fixation. You know, the school psychologists want to take my squeeze machine away from me. And Mr. Carlock, my science teacher, was saying, let's read in the library to try to find out why it relaxes you. You know, take that fixation and make it into something of value. Use that great motivation of that fixation to do something good. You know, fixation's a great motivator. Redirect it. You've probably all heard about the case of Nadia, who was an autistic girl that had beautiful drawings. And they said as she got more socially adept, she gave up drawing. I don't think she would have had to have given up drawing. I think if the talent had been nurtured and broadened out, Nadia was drawing stuff on paper bags and on napkins. Somebody should have been giving her art supplies and proper paint and proper paper to draw things on. You know, and broaden that interest out. Yeah, there's been a lot of stuff in the literature about, you know, cognitive abilities in autism. And the one thing I forgot to mention earlier was Woodcock-Johnson's test. One of the tests called concept formation, I flunked. Now, I really resent that being called concept formation because the reason I flunked it had nothing to do with understanding the concept. What it had to do with is I couldn't remember what the concept was, like big and yellow, and then go through the rest of the cards. You know, if I could have written it down, I would have remembered. Now that's the picture of the mountain lion walking around in a cage, pacing. You know, some people, I have a lot of people asking, what's the difference between a stereotypy and a fixation? Well, a stereotypy is something like, you know, hand flapping or rocking. A fixation is they get a nonstop interest in something like airplanes. Well, if they got a nonstop interest in airplanes, then use that to teach reading. You know, if a kid is not verbal, use airplanes and models and speech therapy. Use that interest to motivate. Don't stomp it out, but broaden it out so it becomes less, you know, fixated and weird and gets, you know, something useful. Like a lot of these interests sort of have a sensory basis. I mean, airplanes are visually interesting, but you need to take it way beyond that point where you're reading about airplanes, doing math problems with airplanes, you know, doing something that could ultimately become a career that has something to do with airplanes. Now that's the original cattle squeeze shoot out of my aunt's ranch. And I put that there because I want to talk about the people that really helped me. And a lot of people like, who helped me and who was not so helpful? Well, when I was a little child, the people that were the most helpful were my mother, governess, and a speech therapist. When I was very, very little, 3 years old, 2 years old. And when I got into school, it was good, ordinary, regular teachers. I went to a small, normal school, small classes, but a normal school with older, experienced teachers. Mother integrated me in. You know, she explained to the other kids to help cut down on the teasing problem, which can be a terrible problem. Then I get into high school. The people that helped me the most were my science teacher, the unconventional people. And I hate to say it, but my school psychologists are here. They were some of the least helpful people. Really hate to say that, but they weren't. The people that helped me the most were the unconventional people who, instead of stomping out my cattle chute, saying, said, hey, let's go to the library and read physiology books to find out why it might be relaxing. And another thing that's important for autistics that succeed is you get a skill and people will respect you. Yeah, maybe people thought I was a nerd, but I could design really good facilities. And when I was in college, as an undergraduate, they used to call me Buzzard Woman and Tape Recorder, and I can tell you, you know, words hurt a lot. You know, they say sticks and stones can break your bones, but words won't hurt you. Let me tell you, words hurt more than sticks and stones do sometimes. But we had a school talent show, and I sung this funny song in it, and I made all the scenery for the talent show. Well, then maybe I was a nerd, but I was a neat nerd then. And I know of another autistic lady who works at Graphic Arts in Illinois. And one of her big social breakthroughs was selling some paintings, exhibiting them in a gallery, and selling some of her art to a bank, and it was hung up in a bank. She got recognition for that. You know, they're going to get their socialization through their skill. I mean, if you let that talent they have die, you're going to end up with nothing. You need to take that drawing talent or that music talent, whatever it is, and nurture that. That's a flower. You've got to water it, nurture it, and make it grow. Let's broaden it out so it's less weird and less, you know, fixated just on one thing. Okay, let's look at Einstein. Well, I know some Einstein relatives, interesting family. Four, autism, dyslexia, and allergies. Allergies, food allergies like you just wouldn't believe. And when you read bibliographical history on Einstein, there's a lot of autistic traits there. Great visualizer. I mean, look at his hair. Not exactly, you know, a colorful style in men's hair. wearing sloppy sweat shirts and dressing like a slob, you know, walking around Princeton campus. And there's autism and genius in that family, in one of the, some cousins, where the mother and the father are Einstein genetics, you know, first cousins married, real inbred, and they've got an autistic son, and they've got a real gifted son right there in the same family. You know, maybe there'd be a terrible price to pay if we stomped out autism and manic depression. Maybe even schizophrenia. Maybe these genes are the spice that, you know, get them just not too big a dose of them. And you get someone like Einstein. You get more than you get, you know, into more problems. You know, I got a little children's book about Einstein describing what he was like as a child. He'd space out and he was not athletic and it was called Einstein, you know, useless that he couldn't, you know, do anything. But he had some lucky things that happened. One of the things that stimulated his mind was he worked with the patent office. Now, if you want to find new ideas, that's where you're going to find them, where he filed patents. And he was a visual thinker. The theory of relativity is all based on visualization of riding light beams, imagining himself inside a closed boxcar, moving in relationship to the Earth moving and the universe moving. Whatever. And in, you know, saying before, in manic depression, we're finding that siblings with manic depression have all kinds of, you know, super creative traits. Take someone like Andrew Lloyd Webber, who's not autistic, but there's a lot of the traits there. You read this article in New York Times Magazine, bad tempered, fixates on one thing, separates, great musical talent. You know, some of the traits are there. I think it's a continuum. I want to finish up with this. Twin colts, one sunburn on the nose, it's all that stuff on his nose. These animals are genetic, identical twins. Interesting thing here is that the white on their face is not identical. Similar, but not identical. Genes seem to be able to put the same face on two people, but they can't put the same white stripe on the horse's, down the horse's face. Now, you're not going to get one that's going to have like a white head and the other one have a black head. That won't happen. They'll be similar, but not the same. Well, that white stripe forms at the same time that the brain is doing its great formation. That means the brain of those two colts is not quite exactly the same either. It's tremendous. You know, the genetics is not able to tell every brain cell where to grow in the brain. Maybe that's why one person might be an Einstein and another one might be a real bad case of cancer. And even in identical twins, you get what they call a 95% concordance rate. That means if you have identical twins, one's autistic 95% of the time, the other one will be. But not 100% of the time, and in those twins, usually one will be worse, have worse autism than the other. You know, those brains are somewhat different. I just want to finish up. Tell you, little nerve endings here, little nerve endings do grow. You know, even when a person is, you know, even an adult, little nerve endings still grow. We need to never forget that. That's the end of my slides, and we can probably do about an hour of questions. I'm more than happy to do questions. Okay.
Can you name some famous people who are autistic?
Well, I can't prove that they were autistic, but I have strong suspicion. Howard Hughes, and I think the reason he got all isolated in the end, the nerves ate him up. At first, his fixations enabled him to do his airplane company. But then as he got older, the nerves got worse. This happened to me. My nerves got worse and worse and worse. And thank goodness I, you know, found a little pill. Another person who I think had a lot of autistic traits is Tesla. He's a famous electrical genius. He was born around the 1900s. He invented I don't remember exactly, but it's a very, very important thing involving power stations and the transmission of electricity.
Where was this amusement park that you were at with doing this round and round thing?
Oh, where was the amusement park I was at? It was in Massachusetts, a place called Nantasket Beach, and they've unfortunately torn it down, but the rotor exists in other places. Yeah, it's manufactured by Chance Manufacturing Company in Wichita, Kansas.
Why did they tore it down?
I don't know. You know, they're always changing things around.
Being a great visualizer that you are,
would you be characterized as savant?
Well, I don't have the kind of savant skills. Well, the question was, would I be a savant? I can't count cards and things like that, or do the multiplying Joe Sullivan do. But what I can do is I can think about how they would do it. I got to think about the card count. You know, you're at the casino and you've got, you know, either 6 or 8 decks of cards in this shoe, and they deal the cards out of it, and you've got to remember all the cards. Well, I think he does it visually. I'm thinking now, if I had to make myself do this, I'd imagine laying the cards out as they're dealt in an array on the floor, some kind of pattern. And then I can look at my pattern and see which cards are missing. And the reason I think this is how they do it is I've read about expert abacus on people that can use the abacus, the Chinese bead calculating thing. And they can do it as fast as an electronic calculator. And they can get so good that they don't need the abacus anymore. They just do it in their mind. But the thing is, that abacus is still there as a picture in their mind, and they're pushing those beads around in their mind. And I can't do the savant things, but I can imagine how they would do it. I think it's a visual thing. And one comment, I was very sorry to find out that Dr. Rickwell said on Entertainment Tonight that a savant skill is a trick anybody could learn. I just flat don't believe that, especially on card count. Only on the things I've read about it, the only savant skill that might be kind of a trick is square root fun. I can't do it, but I read a paper where it explained how to do it, and they could train normal people to do it. The fact of the matter remains that normal people don't spontaneously learn to do it. But card counting and some of these other things that they're doing, I think it's a visualization thing coupled with extreme concentration. See, I don't have the concentration to hold the image. But I was thinking, okay, you got 8 decks of cards, you got 4 suits. And if you ever played that game clock where you lay the cards out, you know, like the 3 is at the 3 o'clock and the 6 is at the 6 o'clock. Well, I can have like the clock for hearts, a clock for clubs, a clock for diamonds, and a clock for spades. And then I'd lay the cards out in a special pattern for each 8 decks. So and it'd be like a pattern, or like a pattern on a Persian rug. Sort of thing, and then I could look and see what cards are missing. Those cards are still in the shoe and haven't been dealt. So I got thinking about how he could do it, but I don't have the concentration. I can't hold the image without it breaking up that long. See, when I do my images for cattle handling, you know, the image is constantly moving in my mind, and if the image, you know, if I get a little lapse of attention or something, it doesn't matter. But you see, if I'm trying to count those cards, you get one little lapse and you've lost.
At what point were you verbally competent and what contributed to developing?
Okay, the question was at what point I was verbally competent? By 3.5 to 4, I was, you know, I still had hesitancy in my speech, but I could talk, and the main factors in getting me to talk, speech therapy clinic, and the teacher knew just how hard to push. She take me by the chin and make me look her in the eye, and she'd say, now say fall. And she knew just how hard to push. And I think another thing that's important is you always got to give opportunities for speech. If you've got a child that's just starting to speak, don't say just parrot back, you know, please give me the, you know, please pass the, you know, I was going to say the milk today, we shouldn't give him the milk. Pass the potatoes. But you don't want to just parrot. Like one mother out in California was really good working on speech. Her little boy wanted something. She said, now you have to ask me, you know, in the right way. You know, give me a cookie or... She never let him parrot it just back. But always giving opportunities to use speech, you know, always pushing to get the speech out, but not to the point where he gets so frustrated that he just have a tantrum.
Were you able at that point to express then what you were thinking at the same time?
Yes.
And have the fourth section come later?
Okay, the question was, once I could talk and express what I was thinking, yes, I could, but I was still slow in my talking. And people often wouldn't give me enough time to get it all out. I remember one very frustrating thing in kindergarten, we had a word book. We had to mark all the pictures that began with B. They had a picture of a bicycle, but I didn't mark it because trike I didn't know that it was in a trike and a bike, and I had a trike. I thought, you know, it was a trike, so I didn't mark that. The suitcase I marked because I thought it was a bag or a box. Well, but the teacher didn't give me time to explain why I marked it certain way. She said, well, that's just wrong. She didn't give me time to explain that I marked the suitcase because, you know, I thought it was a bag.
I have two questions for you. You talked a little bit about how you were bothered by teasing as you went to school. Did you form friendships? And at one point, did you form friendships? And my second question is, how do you deal with conventional people?
Yeah, the first question was forming friendships. When I was a little kid, I had some good friends. And the people that I, you know, was the best friends with were people who like to make things. You know, we like to build a treehouse. I remember one exercise in fourth grade, we were studying cavemen, and we had to go make, you know, like a stone spear. I remember my friend Eleanor and I going out and kind of chip rocks, you know, make a spearhead out of it, fasten it onto a stick. We couldn't use any artificial stuff yet, like only use stuff found in the woods. Tie the spearhead onto a piece of, you know, vine. And so there were certain kids that, you know, were my close friends. But I didn't have a wide circle of friends. Okay, and people are asking now, how do you get along with conventional people? The bulk of my social activities still revolve around something to do with business. Like I have a good friend who's a contractor, and we've built a lot of good jobs together and had a lot of good times together. I have friends in meat plants, I have friends on cattle ranches, you know, and working with those people, you know, in the job setting is probably where I get most of my social life. When I'm at home, I spend all my time drawing and writing my letters, and I don't, you know, I don't, like at the university, I had, you know, like one girl there was a really close friend of mine, Tina. We'd always be doing things together, but I didn't fit in with all the, you know, the departmental stuff. Even now, you know, my social life revolves around something to do with some kind of work that I'm doing. I have a lot of friends in autism society. You know, and we can talk about two things I'm interested in, livestock and autism.
Do you still use the squeeze machine, and how often is it routine?
And the question was, do I still use the squeeze machine? Yes, I do. Now, since the nerves have been calmed down, I don't have the feeling to use it now so much to calm the nerves. But I use it because I think sometimes I just need to get the feeling of comfort so I keep my empathy level up and keep my neurotransmitters, you know, primed up in the brain.
You talk in your book about your fourth grade, for example, your fixation on lecture, and you're constantly asking questions, and yet you are a good student. What worked for you? What did your teachers do that helped you get on to your reading and get on to your...
Okay, the question was, what helped me get on with my reading? In some things I was a good student, other things I was a bad student. Science, I was a good student, that interested me. Reading, and really mother's the one that has to get the credit for that, teaching me to read phonetically, gradually, you know, sounding out my words. But the things that motivated me were things that were interesting to me. You know, you take that election poster business, I flunked so the social studies. Somebody should have taken me down to the state capitol and shown me the governor's office and who the people on the posters were. Now, interesting enough, that did start out with a sensory basis, because I like to wear posters and get the pressure against my body. And Lorna King has found that if she gets an x-ray vest, one of these things that keeps x-rays off, weighted vest, puts it on these kids, they'll be less hyperactive. Now, I don't recommend an x-ray vest. I got lead in them. My children eat it. Die of lead poisoning. But you can make a weighted vest with you know, like sand pockets in it. And I know quite a few OTs that just put that on a hyperactive child and they'd be really, really calm. See, in the posters, I like the idea of wearing it like a sandwich board. But okay, that's what started the interest, but you can take that and broaden it way out, because I then did sort of get interested in Whittier, who's the governor of Massachusetts, and that could have been broadened out to make an interest in studying social studies. You know, government. What is government? You know, who is this man on the poster? What does he do in governing our state? That's social studies. A trip to the capital would have worked wonders on motivating me to, you know, and not mess around and not pay attention to history. See, the thing was, history wasn't real to me. But if I had gone in and seen the Capitol building, that would have really seemed real.
Could I have Dr. Hardy's in Boston's full name on how I begin to contact with
him? Yeah, his name is Paul Hardy. His phone number is 617-956-0105. Office number.
Thank you. Okay, let's see. Just a quickie, where is the Mountain Country School located?
Well, actually, it should say the Hampshire Country School. I changed some of the names in the book because my parents have still got some real problems with not accepting, you know, the autism, and my mother doesn't ever want to contact me. So I had to change some of the names in the book so no one tracked down where my mother is. She, unfortunately, is a product of the fatal Bettelheim era and feels somehow she goofed me up. But she did. You know, if it hadn't been for her, I wouldn't have been anywhere. Actually, it's a Hampshire Country School in New Hampshire.
Did you ever try meditation for your nerves?
Yes, I did. And by doing some of these things and doing a squeeze machine, yes, it calmed me down. But it was like, I'm going 200 miles an hour, and if I did these things, I'd get down to 125. But I could never get it down to 55. It's only now that I'm taking the drugs that I've gotten my nerves down, you know, to a normal level. Before, it was like my engine just raced. You know, you've got a car in neutral, and the gas pedal's floored, and the engine's racing. Now, if I calm myself down, I might be able to get it so it wouldn't race quite so hard. But it never idled normal. You know, it's like the idle screw of the carburetor of the brain has been reset. And, you know, and I think in some cases maybe we can control it without drugs. We use, you know, sensory methods and exercise. They don't have such a nervous system arousal, over-arousal, we may be able to deal with it without using a drug. But unfortunately, this nerve problem tends to get worse as people get older. You know, the older I got, the more trouble I had, more flights attacks, more health problems, just falling apart. You know, my father's got a lot of the same kind of nervousness. And his health has just gone completely to hell. He's got all kinds of weird infections caused by immune system, maybe stress that, and I can't seem to talk him into taking the drug. I hope, you know, maybe I can. But I think there's a point where a nervous system gets so over aroused that, you know, it's going to need a little help or a little chemical to get it down. There may be other people, maybe they take the vitamins and it will work. There may be others, maybe meditation will work. I'm not saying that we should just, you know, go running for drugs is way too much, just going out and running for drugs. But I think especially in autistic deteriorated puberty, and this great nervous system over arousal takes place, and there's going to be a proper use for drugs. I used to be totally anti-drug. You know, 8 years ago, if you asked me, I was totally anti-drug. But, you know, it's just made such a difference, and it also made such a big difference in how other people, you know, other people's evaluation of my behavior has been so much improved. But getting back to the secondary damage, maybe if we work on these kids really young, and we get this tactile stimulation in when they're very, very young, we won't get this terrible over-arousal problem with puberty. Because I know in rat babies, that if you handle the rat babies, when they grow up, their nervous systems are much calmer and they have less stress hormones. In other words, the handling of a very young animal affects that nervous system when they grow up. You know, and maybe if we can prevent some of this secondary damage in a young child, you know, anywhere from 2 to maybe 5 or 6 year old child, we can prevent the secondary damage from taking place, maybe they won't need a drug when they hit puberty. We just don't know. I am speculating now. I want to make it very clear that I have just speculated, and it's not fact to be speculating.
Do you find it, when you were starting in college, your concentration span, like, did you mention something about taking a tape recorder to classes? I have a 15-year-old daughter, and we can see that I'm concerned about her being able to attend college because of her. She just doesn't seem to be able to concentrate enough.
question concerns concentration in college. I have problems with tuning out. And actually, I don't like, you know, play attention. I don't like auditory information. I'm a visual person. Now, the way I deal with that is constantly take notes. You always take notes, even if you're going to throw them away. Just take notes, because the act of taking notes will stop you from tuning out. Now, if I don't take notes, I will lose over half the information if I just go to a verbal lecture and there's nothing written on the board and there's no slides. But if I take notes, I retain it so much better. It's the act of taking the notes. And she needs to start doing that, because written information is much easier to deal with than long strings of verbal information. If someone gives me directions just verbally, and there's more than three terms, I can't remember. But if they write it down, then it's just fine. You know, and she ought to try, you know, doing that.
Now that you refer to yourself as recovered, what are the signs of a good prognosis for an autistic child?
I mean, when you're looking at a very young child?
Young, middle, the whole bit.
Well, okay, when a child is very, very young, you know, like 2 to 3 years old, I mean, I don't want to speculate. I mean, unless you've got, you know, heavy-duty, obvious brain damage. I mean, if you've got a child with multiple seizures and they can't stop the seizures, I think the prognosis is going to be quite bad. But let's say you have a child where there's no gross pathology. Maybe he's got a small vermis of the cerebellum and he doesn't have anything really else wrong. If he gets the right treatment, he may have a real good prognosis. In fact, my hunch is that the small vermis of the cerebellum may be something they're going to want to find in the brain scan. Now again, that's speculation, it's not fact. There's only been the 2 studies done, and we don't really know how to interpret those studies. Really little kids, I mean, you just don't want to speculate. If you start working on them, some kind of program, and they start improving, it's hard to say. You know, then you get into the whole puberty thing. You know, where half of autistics get worse. There's some autistics in puberty actually get better. There's some where puberty itself is terrible, and then once puberty passes, they'll get better again. I was one of the kind, and girls tend to be worse for deteriorating at puberty than men are. And I was one of the kind that once the nerves came, man, they stayed, the older I got, the worse. I'd fight those nerves. Let me tell you, it took, you know, willpower to fight it. And the little pink pills came along just in time. I was getting on the rocks. I mean, I was totally falling apart physically. I was, on the verge of nervous break. You know, Mr. Carlock hadn't taught me how to go to Index Medicus and find the Shannon Carney paper. That was my salvation. I was just looking at that paper the other day. I was like, holding it, like it's the Bible. You know, the source of my salvation. But if you work on these kids when they're little, see, prior to 9 years old, brain is plastic. Maybe even stop some of these changes taking place. I have a feeling that some of these bad things that happen are due to sensory deprivation, mainly tactile deprivation. Again, this is speculation. You want to look at the animal literature, this is what the animal literature tell them. It's the way I interpret animal literature. I don't like to speculate on prognosis, because like John Rady got a head banging total mess off the back ward with beta blockers. IQ of 120, the guy was like in a rubber room. He got him out with beta blockers. And you know, we're learning new things all the time. Every day we're learning things, new drugs, new ways of dealing things, with things. So it's really hard to say what prognosis is, especially if there's no heavy duty brain damage. Unfortunately, I am finding in some of the autism groups, you know, parents are coming up and it's obvious the child has got heavy, heavy, heavy brain damage. And autism is just a secondary symptom. It ought to be called, you know, heavy brain damage with autistic characteristics rather than autism. So they'll be labeled autism so they can get certain services in their state. I'm seeing a lot of that, and it varies from state to state.
You have them said you're recovered autistic person with autism, and refer to other people as recovered. What's your definition of recovered?
Well, a recovered person would be somebody that can have, you know, live on their own independently, maybe with some support, and have a job in the community and function. Maybe they're going to be a bit weird, a bit nerdy, but they're going to function. You know, somebody like Kathy Listener, somebody, this lady in Chicago I was telling you about. There's another lady that sells Mary Kay. She just started on Elavil and Prazosin, those 2 antidepressants. She said they're really starting to do good things for them. You know, goals are, you know, recover. You know, you've got to, you know, be out in the community doing things in order to be considered recovered.
So it's like your major handicap and condition used to be autism, but now it's more convenient, and you're really don't have a major handicap and condition.
Not now, especially before taking the drugs. Prior to taking the drugs, his nerves was just torture, absolute torture. I mean, I felt miserable all the time. I used to think it was normal, but people would feel like, you know, medical licensing exam nerves or teacher licensing exam nerves were the nervousness. I used to think it was normal to feel that way. I thought all people felt that way. And you don't believe, you see, it's like a revelation when it went away. You know, I thought, my God, you know, biochemistry. I mean, it was like a, I don't know, it's hard to say what it's like. Okay, let's take this man here in the back.
Wouldn't it be a similar response to the swimming machine?
Okay.
Therapy pool or something?
The question concerned using swimming as therapy. I think swimming would be excellent therapy, both for adults and for little kids. You know, it's great sensory activity, it's exercise, and I think it would help reduce nervous system arousal. I think it's a great activity. Now, for it to really work, they're going to need to do it, you know, every day. To really make, you want to make it, use an activity to reduce nervous system arousal, especially in an adult, you've got to do it every day. Because the possibility with these little kids, if we work on the tactile stuff, maybe we can prevent damage, secondary damage, possibly. In an adult, it's like, you know, like taking the medicine. You stop taking the medicine, it doesn't work anymore. You know, some people have criticized some of the sensory things, that we have to keep doing it to make it work. Well, I say, well, look, you got to take blood pressure pills every day to make the blood pressure stay down. You know, in an adult, you'd have to do the swimming every day to keep it working. Where if you work on breaking down tactile defensiveness and stopping little kids from withdrawing, you may actually, you know, prevent damage. You know, you may have sort of a different situation than an adult. But I think it's great. I know of therapists that use swimming, and it's been a really good thing. Okay, let's take this man again.
I've noticed that my 8-year-old is not capable of doing things like tying his own shoes or going to the bathroom by himself. And when he sees his 2.5-year-old sister do them, I'm trying to decide, is he capable, or were you in your...
I could do that. I had, you know,
But my question is, are you capable of noticing that your peers or your siblings are passing you in normal everyday functions, and how does that affect you as someone who has the ability to recognize that but can't do anything about it?
The question was, you know, how do you feel if you notice your peers are passing you in everyday functions? Okay, in my case, you know, I was, other than my balance thing and not being able to ski, other sports things I did well in. I could throw and hit the ball well on, you know, when it came to like playing, you know, softball with the other kids. I mean, I could play decently. I could tie my shoes. I could go to the bathroom by myself. Those sort of things, they weren't surpassing me. But I was always left out socially. You know, like sometimes they'd, well, for the baseball game, they picked me first because I was a good hitter and a good catch. But something where it was just strictly a social thing, you know, I tend to get left out, and that did hurt. You know, and I wonder, what am I doing wrong? Even as an adult, when I was like 30, 25 years old, and I was a reporter for a magazine, I found that people would talk to me as a reporter, but they didn't want to talk to me socially. And I go, what am I doing wrong? And then I find out later on from people that like saw me before taking this drug and after taking it, telling me how much my voice changed, how much I changed. I mean, maybe I was just weirder than hell. The thing is that I didn't recognize that, and I didn't have the kind of thing like not being able to tie my shoe, which I would have obviously noticed that. I definitely noticed in skiing that I couldn't learn the Christie and the other kids could, and that was very frustrating for me. So I think he probably, you know, has some frustration.
So it adds to the frustration.
Well, I'm sure it doesn't help it. I hope you've got a good OT working with you that's helping you getting to do some of these things.
What do you attribute the poor eye contact to, and what can be done to improve that?
Okay, the question concerns eye contact, what causes it, lack of eye contact. You know, even now when I get kind of nervous when I go to the airport, I like avoid the gate agent's eyes. It's almost sort of a protective response. Things like working on the sensory activities will often improve eye contact. Working on getting the child to accept being touched will improve eye contact. Like speech therapist would grab him by the chin and make him look right at her. That worked on. Just getting the nervous system calmed down will help on this. And a lot of the sensory integration things and the sensory stuff is great for this. And now, I don't go for this mulch cooling therapy, holding them down kind of nonsense, but a sort of modified working on getting them to accept being touched. All these things tend to, you know, help the eye contact, anything that calms that nervous system down.
You mentioned you're hearing a lot of cases that have heavy brain damage with autistic characteristics. Are there some signs or guides the practitioner, the teacher could use to get an idea whether a child she's working with, who she was told was autistic, really has more heavy brain damage and just autistic characteristics?
Well, the question was, could a teacher in a classroom like figure out just autism versus heavy duty brain damage?
Yeah.
In really young children, that's pretty difficult. You know, if you could have a child that's behaving really weird when they're young, and if you snap them out of it, you can, you know, you can really do a lot with them. The younger a child is, the more hesitant I am saying anything with prognosis. I don't know. You know, a three-year-old, boy, you better just work just as hard as you can. Maybe you can snap them out of it. Now, obviously, if the doctor goes in there and they do brain scans, sometimes gross pathology shows up, but it's hard to talk about prognosis. There have been cases where the whole head was full of water. They were hydrocephalic, but the head never expanded. The guy was in college, and his brain was plastered that thick on the inside of his skull. Now, I would guess the kind of kids that probably would have a bad prognosis. If you've got constant, uncontrolled seizures in a child, that's bad news. You know, if it's just going on and on and on and on, and you can't control it. And a lot of autistics do have seizures, and generally, the more seizures they have, you know, probably the worse it would be. But it's really hard to say. Now, there's other, you know, things they can look at, you know, motor coordination, and but in the real young ones, it's hard to know exactly how retarded they're going to be. You know, now if a child's something like Down syndrome, you've got a pretty good idea. But they found in Down syndrome, and again, if you use the right educational methods, you know, to stimulate these kids, you can really build up the functioning. You're not going to make them normal, but they're going to work at a much better level than if you didn't do anything with them at all. But basically, it's hard to say in real young children. Then as they get older, you're going to get a better and better idea of, you know, what they're like. You know, an IQ test, this brings up another thing. You got to make sure an IQ test, where you differentiate between they can't do it or throwing the cards on the floor and they won't do it. And you got to know exactly what happened in the test. Were the cards being chucked around, or was the child really trying to do it? And that's often not show up, and you know, you just get this number. Now, obviously, of course, if you do an IQ test and you do various tests and they come out with the nice high scores on it, then you can say, well, great, you're not retarded. And that's just great. I'd rather see that test used in something to say, well, okay, they're not retarded, than go the other way. We'll say you only get an IQ of 40, so therefore it's not worth trying. You know, maybe the cards are being chucked around the room. That's why he's got an IQ of 40.
You said that there were some side effects in the medication that you were taking aside from worrying disorders and the others?
Okay, on the medication I'm taking, you know, I'm taking a low dose, and probably an adult would get, you know, blurry vision. There's minor side effects, dry mouth, constipation. In males, there's one bad side effect of antidepressants where it's going to shut off the urinary tract. And if that happens, you've got to stop it immediately. the new Prozac, especially bad for that. Also, if a person has seizures, you have to be very, very careful with antidepressants. They do lower on seizure threshold, but the drug I'm on is considerably safer than something like Haldol, which we know causes tardive dyskinesia, which is, you know, Parkinson's-like, you know, movement disorder. Let me try to get somebody that we haven't had at all. Okay, how about this person right there?
I have two questions. I wanted to know what your thoughts were on craniosacral therapy.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear. What kind of therapy?
Craniosacral.
I think
it's being done by an occupational therapist now, manipulation of spine.
I am not familiar with that.
And the cranium? I didn't study. I didn't know what
it was. I don't know. The question concerning craniosacral therapy for autism, I have to say I don't know anything about.
Okay, and then the other question I had was, if you were
going
to go to a program, if you were going to put yourself in a program anywhere in the United States, where would be your first choice?
I mean, like for little kids?
Well, little kids, school age child.
When you say school age?
Yeah, 5, 6.
Okay.
You know, regular school.
Well, there's a number of good programs, you know, around, you know, for little kids that have worked. The Gashi School in Boston is very good. But there's also other programs that have worked. There's a town safe for each program think they have a super special magic. Dr. Lowlock's program, even though it's a behavior mod-based program. Yeah, you know, when you look at what they're doing a lot more sensory stuff than they want to admit to. But for little kids, the program's gotta be intense, it's gotta be structured. Passive approaches just simply, you know, are simply useless. Lorna King in Phoenix has an excellent program, you know, a sensory integration based program. That's an excellent program. Any one of those programs, even though the theoretical bases are different, they're all good programs at work. Mentality programs tend to be passive, and they don't do enough active sort of things, keeping the kids occupied in purposeful activities. You know, I've had parents call me up saying, well, maybe they ought to yank their kid out of school, go to Boston, go to the Gashi School, or sell their house. And I said, wait just a minute. You know, when I get to talking to them, I find out they're already in a pretty good program. Now, if they're in a lousy state like Indiana, one of the worst states, Ohio is another terrible state. In Indiana, they are still classifying autism as an emotional disorder, and God forbid. And if they're in a lousy state like that, maybe they ought to, you know, maybe they consider doing something like that. But unfortunately, in a lot of these programs, and this is something that there are quite a few of the programs guilty of, they sort of get to like having their religion, and they almost get like a cult. And they say, like, I'm the only one who's got the magic that can solve the problem. The truth is that any one of those programs, well, this Miller School is also good. It's a cognitive-based program. I don't believe a lot of his theory. He's got a really good school. The child would do well there. Either his program, the Gotcha School, Lovost, Lorna King, Derby School in Michigan's good. There's a T.J. Guan out in California's really good. There's a number of programs that work. All these are fine programs. A little 5 or 6-year-old would do well in any of those programs. Now, let's talk about the older kid. Let's look at myself. Imagining back to 4 years old, I think the Gashi School would be good when I was 4. I think the Gashi School would be a disaster when I was 16. It's way too rigid, way too structured. When I was 16, I needed the Mr. Carlock to come along and stimulate my scientific interest and get me directed into something of value. I didn't need to be, you know, jumping around the gym and doing all these structured activities. I would have gone stark out of my mind. So what's a good program for little children is not necessarily the best program, you know, for especially a high-functioning adult. Maybe some of the lower-functioning, I think that Gashi School is appropriate for some of the lower-functioning retarded autistics, you know, they're 16, 17 years old. But for a high-functioning person, I think it would just drive them absolutely nuts. You know, and the same thing. It's just that it's just too rigid. Now, it's a Japanese style. With the little kids, they've done some really good things with little kids. So has Lorna. She's done some great things. And but then when you start looking and seeing what they're actually doing in the classroom, you're going to see a lot of similarities.
You've said that autistics tend to go through severe regression during puberty.
Half, not all. The question is sort of regression periods and half periods.
Are there other regression periods in younger years coming?
No. The main regression period is puberty. You know, you can get through puberty without regressing. You know, get them all the way totally sexually mature. And they get through that, you know, then you're gotten through the worst of it. You know, and then some of the men actually get better after puberty. The regression of puberty is a bigger problem than the women. In fact, one thing interesting that Kita Hara said, he's got to the guys at school, she said, you know, she didn't like to deal with the older girls. She couldn't do anything for them. You know, where some of the boys she could. Now, I think a lot of these girls are candidates for like the kind of drugs that I'm taking. Because other people that I know personally, like this lady herself, Mary Kay, you know, she's a responder to these drugs. I know another girl they tried talking on and it worked fine and they got dosed too high, and that's looking at the literature, looking like the girls have more of a deterioration problem with puberty than the men do.
I just wanted more information on testing for allergies and
avoiding milk and wheat. The question was my test for allergies and my avoiding milk and wheat. It's so mild I haven't gotten bad enough for me to have to avoid them. I do react slightly, and sometimes there's some additives that react to it. I ate a Mrs. Smith's apple pie about 2 months ago, and my throat's got closed up. So does the throat of another person I was with. I don't know what was in it. Normally, I don't have reaction to apple pie, but it was really bad. It was the Mrs. Smith's crumb top, wasn't it? A lot of autistics have got allergies, and if you've got behavior problems, you need to really check the allergy business app. I just know of too many kids when they got them off of wheat or milk or some other food they're allergic to, and they got better. The interesting thing is the food they're allergic to, they often crave it. And another way to track down the allergies is look at the family history. Are there other people in the family? Is there a grandmother that eats strawberries and she breaks out? Or if I eat cashews, they make me really actively sick. I don't have a behavior problem, but I have big digestive problems. Look at the family history and you know, start taking out foods that they react to. They tend to be foods that are common in the American diet. Wheat and milk are extremely common. Now, I've also heard of things with beef allergies, meat allergies, but I don't think that's as common as the grains. Grains are really bad. Corn can be bad, oranges, sugar and chocolate. They tend to be the, you know, like the big hit list. Tomatoes is another one that's sometimes bad. I would guess that 25% of all autistic is severe problem with food allergies. And nobody's going to poo-poo that to me. I've just heard way too much feedback on that from meetings like this.
Can you talk about events or activities that you didn't like to participate in or that drove you crazy, like the clothing? Do you think when children are young, if you help encourage and somewhat force activities on them, that's a good thing? Or should we go with what they like? I have a student who doesn't like to do hardly anything. And I've noticed by almost forcing him to participate that sooner or later he's attending and somewhat liking an activity. But there's some things he absolutely cannot tolerate.
Well, okay, the question was when do you force a student to do an activity? That's a real good question. And the neurologist told my mother, you know, way back, you know, 42 years ago, or it would be 38 years ago, use your good instincts. You know, like forcing me to wear the hat and the itchy chin band, that was wrong. But saying, come on now, we're going to go to church, staying home from church, that would not be the right thing to do. Use your instincts. You know, if you're finding you kind of force one activity and he does it, great. Because I think you can't be passive with these kids. Otherwise, they're going to just sit in the corner and they're going to do nothing. Now, there's some, you know, getting into food things. You know, there's certain foods that texture-wise are just terrible, like raw egg white. No one's going to make me eat that. But on the other hand, you just let a kid just end up eating nothing but bread to get some nutritional deficiency. That's not any good. And, you know, use your instincts. It already sounds like you've got a pretty good idea of what you want to do. You're the one who's willing to. Do what you find works.
what would your advice be for either this person or the family of this person, sort of a Dustin Hoffman type character, a 35-year-old man, genius IQ, living at home, delivering pizzas, very much lost in life, and to this point has been either misdiagnosed or really not diagnosed, but this seems to fit. Where to begin?
Does he have actual savant skills?
No, but probably not two, about 150.
And he's delivering pizza. It's really sad. My IQ of 150 delivering a pizza. Well, I'm afraid he didn't have a Mr. Carlock when he needed him. One of the things that's been showing up in the literature, these higher functioning, the ones that succeeded had a mentor. They've been in about the high school age to guide them, to be sort of a role model, guide them into something constructive. You know, to get this man going, you need to get him interested in something. Get that 150 IQ into interested in some math problem, anything. You know, and then, you know, try to, you know, rekindle the flame to get interested in something other than pizza. And this brings up pizza delivery. This brings up another thing. I've often thought, if I took taken the drug too soon, maybe I wouldn't have become internationally known in livestock handling. Fixations are great morphing. Man, I fixated on that cattle chute thing, and I'd go after those feed yards, and by God, I was going to learn everything there was about the feed yards and about livestock. And then once the drug came, yes, I don't fixate on it so much, but I'm still interested. The interesting thing I noticed happened to me. The things I was interested in and fixated on prior to taking the drug still are more emotional and more emotionally involved in. Like if I call up my answering service and there's a problem on a job, I start getting really excited and upset quickly. Okay, when I worked on my PhD, yeah, I wanted the PhD, but that was never as important to me because that started after the drug when my nervous system was less aroused. That's never had the importance to me that building some job at some feedlot or some meatpacking plant has, because that's the thing that I started on, you know, when my nervous system was in such a high state of arousal. You know, I have it in my book, you know, said if I discovered Toffanelles at, you know, 16, maybe it wouldn't have been such a good idea. You don't know. I'm just, again, speculation. But if there'd be somebody who could turn that guy on, is there anything he's interested in?
Science.
Okay, well, somebody needs to, the science person needs to get with him and start trying to rekindle the flame of science. Get him reading books, get him involved, maybe then get him involved enough where he can get some job working in a research lab, and somebody needs to work with him, but he needs a mentor that can rekindle that science flame, and he needs to be doing something a lot better than delivering pizza. You know, like, does he like to read? Is he a reader?
He's a, yeah. Real Dustin Hoffman type, not quite savant, but at least I know of. Writing a lot of that, I mean, he was at one point a PhD or a physics major, 4.0 at the University
of Minnesota. And what happened to the physics major? Why didn't
I think he kind of got misdiagnosed as emotional problems, decided to go into therapy in California.
Well, I think a lot of misdiagnosis. I think someday, in another 15 years, so all the diagnosis, these things all be done by computers and brain scanners, you know, where they can make an absolute diagnosis of exactly where the brain is. And, you know, and then we deal have counseling to deal with emotional problems, and we'll separate the two things out. And I mean, I've really been heavy on biology, and I don't want to say make think I'm just throwing away, you know, behavior and learning and emotion. Because that's very important too. There's a point where biology overwhelms. There was no way in heck I was going to get rid of those nerves, no matter how much therapy I went in. Those nerves wouldn't have gone away. So I had to take chemistry to get rid of them. But on the other hand, you take problems like being teased, problems socially. That's where counseling, where Mr. Carlock, he also was my counselor, he could counsel me as to how to deal with some of these problems. The drug is not going to solve those kind of problems. Let's talk to this lady in the back.
Did reading help you understand other people's behavior and emotions and other things like that? Or did you have to understand it through interaction with people?
Well, the question was, did reading help me to understand? Yes, because a lot of my, I have every interaction I have with people, I think, well, it is like something I read in the paper. It's like something I read in Dear Abby, or it's like this. I have to relate it back to something that I've read. The older I get, the more things I read in the paper, especially about international politics and international affairs. You know, like, Gaddafi's like a bad boy that wants to see how much he can get away with doing. You know, this chemical plant he's got. And you can almost relate this to, you know, how a little kid being a brat, you know, poke the U.S., you know, throw a cherry bomb at the principal's office. I mean, that's what Gaddafi was doing with those airplanes. I mean, he baited us to shoot them. You know, it was like a little kid throwing a cherry bomb at the principal's mail. You know, that's the kind of way that I relate. You know, I think, well, okay, this situation is like such and such I read in the paper. Now, when I was a lot younger and I didn't have Wall Street Journal, New York Times to read, Newsweeks and all that, you know, then I'm related to something physical like sliding glass doors. But I tend not to do that now. I tend to relate to things I've read in books and magazines, maybe even in novels. Situations I read.
Yeah, I kept observing my daughter that she doesn't seem to have much empathy.
That's typical.
Was there ever a point in your life in which you began to be concerned about other people's problems? Or is it your autism is just such an isolation that you're just so concentrated in yourself that your reality is the only thing that you care about?
Well, again, the question was, you know, how do I develop empathy? I think you get these nerves calmed down, it makes it easier to think about something else. I mean, if you're I was so nervous all the time, all I could think about was trying to keep the nerves from making me absolutely, completely miserable. Now, a lot of the, read in the literature, a lot of high-functioning autistics kind of know intellectually how the other person feels, but they may have a hard time feeling. In my own situation, there's some things where I get very emotionally upset about, extremely emotionally upset. I can, read some sad thing in the paper about some little boy dying of cancer and start crying. And then there's some other thing that goes on and doesn't affect me that much. It's like I have a really empathetic on some things I can read about the Make-A-Wish Foundation, this little boy got to go to Disneyland and he's got leukemia, read that and cry. Some other thing, thing I might not have much reaction to at all. But I intellectually understand how the person is feeling.
I'm the mother of two autistic daughters, and I was wondering, once in a while my one daughter, especially who's mute, will all of a sudden spontaneously break out into laughter or tears. And I wondered if you could explain this. And also, how do you react or get involved with their feelings, and if they're in pain, how do you figure out where the heck it is if they don't?
They can't tell you.
Right.
Probably. The question was, like spontaneous giggling. I used to giggle about inappropriate things, and it was almost like a seizure. And if I kept talking about certain naughty things I did when I was a kid, like smashing up the teacher's garden, I shouldn't be laughing about that. It's not funny. But I'll sometimes get to laughing and I'll get to almost like a seizure and I can't stop. It just comes on and I just keep laughing about it. Now on the other thing about how do you know when they feel pain, it's a real problem. It's like, figuring out how much, pain an animal would be feeling. They can't tell you either. You got to look at their behavior. And animals, if they're in pain, they tend to move around less because it's from the moon. That's a real problem. If she's got a stomach ache, she isn't able to tell you she's got a stomach ache. Now, I know that I'm not an expert in this. It's hard for me to relate to the, some of the more lower functions. But, there's some teachers have done a lot of work with picture cards. Give the person picture cards so that they can use those to communicate. Does she have a tendency to have pain, do you think?
Well, it's just when she has, it's been very frustrating to me. She does use some sign language the herd, but then she doesn't point usually. Then she'll point wherever you point. It's just like the mimicking and ask the song to repeat. You just said where.
She doesn't understand that.
I'm not sure. I believe she has a pretty comprehensive language as far as deceptive.
Yes.
As far as expressive, not very much. So I don't know. It may be hard to,
you know, something that it's hard to say, because I was talking with a, you know, trying to figure out, you know, let's say you're trying to figure out if a certain drug is going to work. Well, they can't tell you. See, like, I took a drug, I mean, I can tell whether it worked. And the lady who sells, her name is Mrs. Rowland, the Mary Kay lady, and she takes a pill, and she knows whether it works. She could, you know, when we were talking about it, she says, yeah, I started taking this stuff, and I don't feel as nervous. But if you have someone that can't tell you, it's really, really difficult. You know, maybe they're getting side effects and they can't tell you that, you know, their mouth is so dry they can't stand it, or maybe the vision is blurred. It's a, you know, it's a really hard thing. I don't have any easy answers. Maybe some other people that have worked with the picture cards and with some of these communication things are going to fight better on that than I can.
Is there any diagnostic procedure other than a tracheal X?
Okay, the question was, is there any other genetic test to get a positive diagnosis for different kinds of autism? The Fragile X test is one. Let me tell you something about that. The test is lots and lots of false negatives. If you get a positive, you can say, yes, you've got it. But if you get a negative, you can't always say, no, you don't. It's also $400 a throw, so it's expensive. Now, on the other kinds of things, the other genetic types, there are no tests. The best way to track it down is, okay, let's look at the pregnancy history. Did the mother get germ measles during pregnancy? She did, and there's autism, the chances are she developed. You know, was there a DPT reaction, you know, to the vaccination, or encephalitis in the very young baby, or extremely high fever? And then look at family history. Does the family history have some of the typical autism markers? Like, you know, dyslexia in the family, genius, the things I mentioned, manic depression, panic and anxiety, immune system problems, and left-handedness. These are all, and allergies, all tend to be some of the markers. Do any autistic traits show up in a real mild degree in other family members? If they do, it's probably genetic. If there's autism in the family, then it's probably genetic if you can rule out pregnancy insults and things like rebellion. You know, you kind of have to do a detective game to figure out what caused it. You can never be absolutely sure because they're finding, for example, schizophrenia. Yes, it's genetic, but there might be two or three different kinds of genetic sequences that cause the same thing. You know, that might also be true in autism. Fragile X is one that is diagnosable. But also, when you're trying to diagnose Fragile X, you've also got to look for markers. There are physical abnormalities that go along in the family. Usually there's going to be mental retardation in the family if it's Fragile X, somewhere, on at least one side of the family.
I have a six-year-old who was born with kidney disease that went undiagnosed until he was 3 months old. At that time, he went into respiratory arrest due to dehydration. We had to do CPR.
That's all of 6 months.
Yes. However, did not show signs of autism until he was 3. Why would that be? He was talking at age 2. Now at age 6,
that didn't get any regress. That is a type of autism where they'll start to talk normally and then they regress. It's a definite subtype.
But you would relate that to the dehydration or the kidney disease or the...
Hard to say.
Right.
It's hard to say. But the guy that had chemotherapy who had his sperm messed up, he had a child like that. It's just not known. You know, maybe the kidney disease caused it, maybe it didn't. That is a specific kind of autism. Your classical genetic canners is not that kind. They don't develop normally and then regress. They are always abnormal until you get them out. And I couldn't say for sure.
Well, he's being tested for possible metabolic things right now.
Well, he may very well. Another thing I've run into is that where they do the PKU test on the baby and they miss. They get a false negative when it really was positive.
That might have happened also.
And that's bad
news. Projectile vomiting and all that stuff at an early age too.
you know, if they slip through that and they don't get on a special PKU diet. And there are some metabolic kinds. Mary Coleman has worked on that. And I don't think they're quite as common as she says they are, but I think they do, they definitely do exist. Again, we're getting into really unknown. I mean, the knowledge is sketchy. There's new research being every day, being done every day, and finding out more and more things. But the chances are, you know, look at your family history. If your family history has any of the markers, if it doesn't, then the chances are that this is some kind of insult caused.
My son has a neurodegenerative
disease. He has a one, I'm sorry.
He has a neurodegenerative disorder, and he has become retarded until he was five and autistic at six. And it seems like some sensory deprivation has exacerbated his autism. Have you ever heard of anything like that?
Okay, question concerned on normal, you know, seizure, degenerative seizure disorder with normal development, then regressed and like became autistic, became retarded at five and autistic at six.
Right.
I have to say this is the first case of this I've heard of. I don't know anything about this condition.
It's similar to Rett syndrome.
Oh, okay. You know, Rett syndrome, which happens only in girls, has an autistic phase they go through.
Right. Is there any way that you can prevent
I don't know anything about the disorder. You're gonna have to ask someone more knowledgeable, and I'm sorry I can't help you. I think they're giving you a cue here that we have to stop, and I'm more than happy I'll hang around for a few more informal questions. I guess we're gonna have to wrap it up.
Again, please remember to fill out these forms.